a very good morning to everyone and a warm welcome again to today's morning session. As always, we try to make it as energizing as possible. So, so to give you a background, you know, I picked up a little more topics on IP strategy. And I picked up a topic on startups, and I'll tell you the reason why. 2 years back, Philips started working with, started a program called HealthWorks, where we decided that we want to also try inorganic way of working with startups. And we set up a different kind of program, and where we started working with startups in India, startups in Eindhoven, Cambridge, and also startups in, I think, China. And during the course of this, you know, the interaction that we had with the startup mentoring program, there was a lot of learning that we came across. Initially, I started off thinking maybe, you know, it's something specific with India, wherein we find a lot of gaps in people's understanding. The entrepreneurs, rest of the world know everything about IP, and then maybe in India always, because we lag a little bit behind the know-how part. But unfortunately not. We started working with several companies in other regions of the world as a part of the India program, and then we realized that, you know, some of these issues are more universal. Unfortunately, by the time these come to us, it's a bit late on the day, you know, for us to even evaluate or consider some of these companies. So the slides I put together are a bit of a learning for me as an understanding and realization of what's happening, and also something I would like to share to the entrepreneurs in terms of what they should be looking at. So some of our slides are going to be overlapping with what Greg already presented, and those I will try to maybe skip or avoid. But I'll try to talk a little bit more on our own understanding and learning from the whole program that we ran from Philips. I know what the first slide already is. I wanted to give, I was also looking for my presentation. When I did the presentation, I was looking at, do I have some tangible data to prove what I'm saying? And what I'm trying to say here is IP actually helps startups, right? So that's a theory for me, but I also wanted to establish the fact that this is indeed the case with some data. So when I started doing my research, I found a well-known paper written by a few researchers in the United States. I didn't have a paper for India, or at least I didn't find one. But for the one in the United States written by the topic of the patent, the paper was The Bright Side of Patents. And as per this, a group of people did some research on a lot of patents in the United States, a few startups that have actually filed for IP. And they found out that when you have patents, it multiplies your chances of success a few times. When you have trademarks, it also multiplies it by a few times. But when you have patents and trademarks together, it actually compounds it, and the value is much, much significantly higher. Right? So with that as a background, I'll talk about... maybe I can still control manually.
This one's not working. I'm controlling it from the console there.
All right. So we start with that, okay? So I can still talk. So the takeaway from this whole message was that, indeed, I think there is some data that proves that the patents are valuable. I know from my own experience that sometimes when we look at startups, the startups that are more interesting are those that have IP and that have IP of value. And in my talk, I'm going to talk a little bit more about what we call as patents that have IP of value. Right? Now, to continue from what Greg said and what I'm sure almost all of you already know, is that there are different types of IP that we look at: patents, trademarks, designs, copyright designs, and so on and so forth. And together, they can be like a basket of assets that you can use. You may not use all at all times. You may use some at some time and the others at the other times. But the important thing to understand is what do you use when and what do you use how, because we all know that startups have limited funding. They have to do more with less. And then how do you use your money judiciously to get the more out of it, right? So and that planning is very, very important and critical early on in your program so that you... get the most out of your money, you're able to allocate your money to the resources that you should, while not compromising on IP, but still making sure that you have enough IP that you need to succeed in your short-term and long-term plans. So we'll pause in the slide for some time. So this is some of the things that that we came across when we were dealing with our startups, right? So a lot of them, when they start off, they have bright ideas. A lot of them are fresh from one of these, the most reputed institutions, college, top college degrees. But when you start looking at, you know, going, one slide before, please go to the previous slide. Yes, thanks. So we realize that, you know, a lot of them have not really thought about the competitors. They have really not thought about the white space that they have to operate. A lot of them completely disregard the fact that they might also be infringing on somebody else's IP. Yeah, there are two aspects of IP that we all know. One is creating your IP, but much before that, what we should be thinking about is not stepping on somebody else's toes, or you could end up in potentially, you know, very, very expensive lawsuits. And we also found that a lot of them, in their zest to do things a lot fast, have really ignored aspects of assignment. They've ignored aspects of making sure that the invention that they develop actually belongs to the organization. They have ignored the aspects of chains of assignment, which my colleague Kunpal will talk later. But a lot of these very, very important things that actually needs to be used to prove that, you know, they actually own the IP. And very sadly so, a lot of them completely disregard all of this, the zest for making money, you know, getting funding and everything. But these days the investors are also getting very smart, right? And the smarter investors are asking for, you know, what do you have as an asset? Do you have bright ideas, but are these ideas really yours? Or do they belong to you, or do they belong to somebody else, or could potentially belong to somebody else? So these are the questions that come in. Yeah. So, and for a startup, I think it's important to understand, take a step back and already think that, what are you going to do in the short term? What are you going to do in the long term? How do you invent? What are you going to invent? What are you going to acquire? And where should you collaborate? Because it's just impossible for you to do everything on your own. You need to have a plan, in principle. And, of course, in the beginning itself, it's important to think, what are your geographies of interest? Okay, if you manufacture in India, are you going to only look at the India market? Or would you, in time, look at China? Would you look at the United States? Would you look at Europe? And do you also start thinking about protecting your IP in these markets, for example? And then the funds are limited, so you need to plan the funding appropriately. And it's not always possible for you to have all IP. You may have to license an IP from other companies. And at this point in time, it's important to think that, you know, will these parties be willing to license to me or not? And you cannot always assume that they will agree. They may not agree later on. So it's important to have a plan, to have these discussions early on, understand from whom you're going to get the IP that's going to supplement your own manufacturing, so that you have everything that you need to succeed. Next slide, please. One slide up. So this is a slide I have to help people to just think about what IP can do for them. Yeah? There are different aspects of IP. On the top left, you have what you actually have as a commercial model. Where you can have this model where you will have IP that is licensable, that's so valuable that it can be licensed out and people will pay a good amount of money for it. On the right side, you have the exclusivity model, which is the ideal model to have, wherein you get a profit margin, a significant profit margin. The area is not crowded. You have enough space to operate. You get most because you are probably one of the unique players in that market. It's a niche segment, so you can maximize your profits, get more money for your IP. And the bottom side is more of cost-saving approaches, which you should also think about. And one is, you know, how do you have a lower-cost product? For example, it can happen that you have overlapping technologies wherein you'll have to cross-license. But you can have cross-licensing deals. Your overall profits may go have to be shared probably. But in the end, it does not affect you so much. But on the right side, you need to have the freedom to operate, so you need to have a defensive model. Sometimes you just build a patent thicket around your technology to make sure that you have enough space to do what you want to do. Next slide, please. Yeah, so a little bit again, because the benefits of IP can be both cash and non-cash. The commercial model, as I said, you will get royalty income via licensing. And it contributes directly to the company's bottom line. Yeah, very good licensing program can be a very good way to make a lot of money for your company. Second is defensive or mitigating, is that it has royalty savings via cross-licensing, and then it also offers freedom to operate in lower product cost. Third one, exclusivity, is protection of market share. You make sure that you have enough market share, enough geographies. You have thinking short-term, you're thinking of long-term, how do you keep getting money over a period of time? And then it translates into higher margins for your products, so you get more profits in the end. The last one is when you realize at some point in time is that your strategy has changed, and then you're not really interested in that particular portfolio which you have built. But your IP should still be strong enough so that you can sell it, or you can give it off as an asset. But at the end of it, nobody is going to take that asset if it's not good IP, good claims, good a strong trademark, right? So you have to start thinking about all these aspects in the beginning, so that at a point in time when you want to divest, you still have enough stuff that somebody would be willing to take from you and also give you good money for it. Next slide. So the other thing which I found was a lot of startups tend to think that IP is costly. And as Greg also mentioned, they try to just avoid it, right? Sometimes you don't like something, you don't want to even look at it. They always push it under the carpet. And you start asking them about these questions, you know, patent? No, patent is going to be very difficult and it's complex and complicated. So I keep telling them that your IP, your patents need not, your technology need not be complex always. It can be something very simple, but it can be something that has more relevance. The larger relevance it has, the larger applicability it has across countries, that much more valuable it is, provided you can protect it. Yeah, based on the legal framework and the jurisdiction and so on. The next slide, please. So another important consideration that we come across is many times people struggle with patents and trademark. They don't know when to do what. But there are two things that you could probably look at while making this important decision so that you don't end up spending money in things that it's not going to get you money back, right? It's not going to be of value. So one of the things is two questions that we need to be asking is it patentable? That's the first thing. And can you detect it if somebody's infringing? The two main aspects. And if it is patentable and if it's easy to detect, then it is a very, very easy answer. That is, you should probably considering patenting it. On the other hand, if you have a situation where it is difficult to detect without a court order, but it's still patentable, maybe it's good to, you know, kind of keep it as a trade secret. But on the other situation, you have a scenario when it's easy to detect, and then it is not patentable either, then, yeah, you can just, it may not be a very valuable technology to have in the first place. It's not going to give you anything out of it. Yeah, this is again a little bit on putting everything together, right? So IP strategy does not work in pieces. You have to consider many things together at the same time, simultaneously. And then you have a moving target. It's not the same. It's not static. So with time, your target keeps moving. Your customers keep moving. Your business partners keep moving, so and technology keeps changing, right? And you have to have a complete view on all these aspects when you decide on your IP strategy. So there are different components to it. One is the technological environment. What are you doing? What are your competitors up to? And what are they doing? And then your customer needs, which is very, very important, because if you're not satisfying a customer need, then there is no business in the first place. There has to be a customer who's willing to take your product. And the customers may keep changing over time. They may keep changing as per the geographies. And having a pulse on your customer is very important at all times. And your competitor activity, your partner ecosystem, and of course the legal environment. Legal environment keeps changing across. Patent laws keep changing. The company laws changing. The regulatory environment keeps changing. And if you don't keep time on what's changing across you, then you may be working on a wrong trajectory altogether. And, I'm not finished. Go back. And then you have the three things that you need to think about is innovate, protect, and leverage. And how do you execute, defend, and exchange your IP, as I spoke in my previous line. But at the bottom of all of it, and the most important, I think, is to make sure that what you're planning to do as an IP department within your own startup or a company is that you're working in line with your company strategy. Does it fit into the strategy? Are you still aligned with what their objective is? Otherwise, things can just fall through. And that may keep changing as well. So companies may start off with something, and over time, they may change into a different business. And that's the point in time where you can possibly think about selling off your IP or divest it so that you are still on track with your company's larger objective and your business strategy. Yeah, and then next slide. And very quickly, I'll talk about this only in the context of the filing time that's required in different geographies. I have an example of United States here, but when your markets are different and your countries are different, you'll have to make sure that you factor in that different countries have different lengths of time to grant patents. And that should be factored in your overall strategy so that you are well within the time that you want to sell those products in the market, so you're prepared for your launch in different markets. And of course, there are cost implications, which you need to factor in as well. And I think one of my co-panelists will talk more about it. Next slide, please. From my own observation and what I've seen from what I've in India, for example, to the extent I'm aware of, I think there are some things that are relevant. So they have, IP gives a significant advantage to VC funding, but the important things to note and where is the value of the IP that you create. It should be a valuable asset that is of value, right? Good patents, good claims, strong trademark, enforceable, all these factors. They fuel employment growth because over time your startup might grow. If it's done properly, and then you may create employment opportunities for a lot of people, increase in your sales, and and there's a lot of research over there which says that there can be strong and persistent positive effects. And the thing is that you also get long-term capital gains. The hurdles, of course, a lot of people point out on and off is that it can actually impact the processing speed of applications in different countries. Can become an important consideration, and you should keep a tab on it because that can really be a roadblock. And that's something you'll have to plan ahead of time. Plan your IP strategy based on these factors. Next slide, please. Yeah. I just have a story because I wanted to pick out something that you can resonate with. I don't have a real story in India, though I think there might be, but I couldn't find it. But this is a story about a Singapore former lawyer. It's a story which is a good success story. So there is a person called Mr. Tan, and he was a former lawyer, and he partnered with another person called Robert Krakow. He met in a PC game quake, right? And then what happened is they decided that they found an opportunity in the market. They decided to partner together, and they decide with products like a mice and a keyboard, and they designed specific PC games. And this was a huge success. And then we have this huge market of people, youngsters, kids, and a lot of people who are, you know, the teenagers and adults who like to do a lot of gaming. And it turns out that this company got a valuation of $1.5 billion. But apparently a lot of the success attributed was because this gentleman or these gentlemen, they decided to do everything right. And also this game that's called Razer, the company is called Razer. They have now diversified into a lot of different activities. But the fact is that being an IP lawyer, he was able to think ahead, plan his way across. And I believe that there are a lot of acquisitions this person did over time, and actually diversifying into a very, very, very profit-making company in the end. So that's a small story, but I'm sure there'll be a lot more like this. But the fact, at the bottom line of this whole thing is that having a good IP strategy can be a long-term success. A startup could become a really big company if you just do things right. So that's my talk. Thank you very much.